Let's pray. Lord, this morning we thank you that what you offer us in Jesus Christ is yourself. What you offer us, Lord,
is relationship and intimacy. And this morning, I pray that you would, by the power of your Spirit, that your word would become so intimate to us that we would allow it to change our hearts.
And Lord, I pray that you would let me get out of the way, that you could speak to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. One of my favorite movies of all time is called Catch Me If You Can. It starred Leonardo DiCaprio and Tom Hanks, and it came out in 2002, and it was a biographical crime film based on the life of a guy named Frank Abagnale. By the age of 19, he has successfully performed cons worth millions of dollars. And what he'd done is he posed as a, first of all, as a Pan American World Airways pilot at 19. And then he got a job as a doctor. And then he got a job as an attorney in Louisiana. He actually found out that he had to pass the bar exam and studied for it for 2 weeks and passed it. Quite an exceptional young man. But his primary crime was check fraud. And he was so good at it that the FBI eventually caught him and put him in prison, but he was so good at it that the FBI took him out of prison and they hired him to help catch other forgers. Now, he was able to claim and look like and act like a pilot and a doctor and an attorney. The thing is, he never would have been able to actually do the job that he pretended that he could do. When I ran a homeless shelter for men, we had a lot of our residents who were war veterans. And every once in a while, someone would come in claiming that they had been in the Vietnam War. The one that really broke me up was a guy who was 35 and told me he had been in Vietnam. I said, "What? Were you born there?" I mean, it's what? And actually, that wasn't even going to work. The thing is, we had people in our lodge that were veterans of the Vietnam War, and it didn't take them any time to recognize that this was a fraud, that this person never had. When someone claimed to be that and they found out that he wasn't, it usually produced a very loud and volatile reaction. Because those who had made that sacrifice weren't fooled for a minute by those who were pretending. There's something real that happens in the heart and the soul of a soldier who has faced the reality and the horror of war. And it's a serious insult to them and to those comrades that they lost to pretend that you were there too. The thing is, the same analogy can be used for those who call themselves Christians, but who do not demonstrate in their lives the transforming power of Jesus Christ or the witness of the Holy Spirit. Today we're in week 4 of a 5-week series on Matthew chapter 5 where Jesus taught what it was to be in an intimate relationship with God. There's a noticeable difference between those who have experienced a life-changing transformation brought about by the Holy Spirit and those who are merely religious and are focusing on being good and acceptable in their own strength. As we discussed last week, Jesus challenged the Pharisees of the law to know the lawgiver intimately instead of seeking to keep the law through their own strength and their own righteousness. Obeying the law of God was to be done out of love for God and a desire to please Him, not as a way to keep rules and therefore somehow show yourself worthy before a holy God. Jesus warned his listeners in Matthew 5:20, "For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." In our Old Testament reading from Leviticus 19 this morning, God speaks to Moses concerning how Israel was to live before God and man as an example of God's own heart. Leviticus 19, 1 and 2 said, "And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, Speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel and say to them, You shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy." Israel was to be God's ambassadors to the other nations, Israel was to reveal that God was the one true and living God, and there was no other. This God was not like men, but he was holy, he was set apart, and he was worthy of their worship and their obedience. And Israel was to also supposed to be holy in that they were to be set apart, that they were to be different. They were to be those who worshiped the law, who worshiped the Lord and obeyed his law. And the idea that God had in mind was that if Israel did this, that the other nations would see the difference and they would come and they too would want to worship and know this God. And then God, in our passage this morning, God gave them examples of what this would look like if they really lived this way, what it would look like. They would be those who are kind and generous to the poor and to the sojourner alike. They would be those who treated each other in honesty and respect. And through their lives, they would bear witness to the love and the mercy that God had shown them. This is the same principle that Jesus is building upon in the Sermon on the Mount. That God's people should reflect the character and the nature of God. And the result would be that God would be called to, they would be called to love this God and to serve him. That those who would see how Christians live and act would be so attracted by the witness of that Holy Spirit that it would call them to repentance and faith. In Leviticus 19, 17, and 18, we see a principle that Jesus refers to in the Sermon on the Mount. "So you shall not hate your brother in your heart, for you shall reason frankly with your neighbor, lest you incur sin because of him. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against the sons of your own people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." That's why you should do it. Last week we discussed Jesus using the example of murder to stress the importance of our hearts being changed by God. The law commanded, "Do not murder." But Jesus gives a far deeper definition by going to the very root cause of murder and explains that anyone that hates his brother has let that seed be planted in his own heart and is guilty of the same sin without even acting upon it. The Pharisees only held that and themselves and others accountable for their outward actions. But Jesus reveals that the Heavenly Father was going to judge them on the basis of their hearts. And most of us here this morning, I'm assuming, can probably say that we've never actually murdered anyone. I'm hoping. Any hands? But how many can claim they've never allowed hatred to run so deep that they can conceptualize the idea of murdering someone? This matter of the heart is serious business and must be dealt with. It's not enough to make a resolution or to not allow hatred or anger to build in our heart or the murderous thoughts to enter our minds. It requires the Holy Spirit's work through the finished work of Christ upon the cross to accomplish this. I mean, we see plenty of examples of unrestrained anger and hatred in the daily news. The murder rate in America is huge right now in some places. But I don't think this is the type of situation that Jesus is referring to in this passage. He's referring to the heart that hides hatred and anger and gives it free rein to roam around in the heart where it can foment and brew. I know the effect of this from some examples from my own family where they did not deal with these sort of things and their lives were ruined by the festering and seething anger that resentment and hatred bred in their hearts. I'm going to share the example with you this morning of two. My father had such an intense hatred of his mother that he used to fantasize about ways he could kill her. He told a psychiatrist this, and the psychiatrist had him admitted to the UVA Medical Center in Charlottesville. He was there for several weeks where they gave him counseling and drugs and the type of therapy that they would do back in the early 60s, but nothing worked. And he came back to Roanoke very discouraged, and for years he was plagued by this and was miserable. And then quite frankly, he was miserable to be around. Until one day my uncle came to Roanoke and shared his faith in Jesus Christ with my father, his brother. And it was the news my dad needed to hear. And my dad broke down on his knees. He cried out to God. And to hear him tell the story, he saw Jesus face to face. I don't think I've ever in my life seen a more radical transformation than the one that I witnessed in my father's life. Because Jesus had completely set him free. And he ended up being used by God to lead his mother to the Lord. Over the years, he testified to anybody and everybody of how God had changed his life and gave him the joy of having love and compassion for his mom. My mother, on the other hand, could never get past the anger and the hatred she had for her father, who had so terribly abused her and her sisters. She never would tell me the details, but later as I was taking care of, I still take care in some way of one of my aunts, and she told me the details, and it was awful. My mother never sought help because she was so ashamed of what had happened, and she so hated my grandfather even after he was dead that she wouldn't even talk about him in any detail. This loathing and this hatred, it colored everything in her life. And every relationship in her life. And I can honestly say that I've seldom seen anyone exhibit the violent rage and the anger that my mother was capable of. I can understand something as an adult that I couldn't understand as a child. My mother quite literally could not love. She did not have the capacity, I don't think. I'm sorry to say that the end result of all this was not the same as my father. At age 47, my mother took her own life. Allowing anger and bitterness and rage to brew in your heart caused you to lose the ability to see God clearly. And instead it allows the enemy to have free reign within you. I want no part of that. I have seen it up close and personal. And I want Jesus' love to rule and reign in me. If you know firsthand what I'm talking about, if you struggle with similar things, Jesus wants to set you free today. Our gospel passage for today continues to drive home the absolute need for allowing Jesus to deal with the issues of our hearts. Let's read again Matthew 5, 27 through 30. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery, but I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. For it is better that you lose one of your members then your whole body be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. For it's better that you lose one of your members than your whole body go into hell. Now here again, it's not simply the act of adultery that Jesus is condemning, but the seed that is planted, that is germinates and is watered, that leads to the state within the heart that makes it possible. I love this song by Casting Crowns, is a slow fade is what it's called. And one of the lines is, daddies never fall in a day. It's a slow fade. And it's responsible for tragedy of broken marriages and ruined lives. And families the world over are subject to this. We live in a culture of pornography where all kinds of despicable things are displayed on in print and on the screen. It's so commonplace that we even see billboards that are erotic and kind of soft porn that would have been unthinkable 20 years ago, but there it is now. And there are those who are striving to force the public school systems to show graphic sex and pornographic pictures to kids to teach them about sex. And frankly, we all know that I could go on and on and on about all the ways that our society has become addicted to perversion and what it's cost us as a nation and as a world. And people often cry out in frustration, how did we let this happen? But the answer is quite simple. We didn't protect our own hearts from the enemy's temptations, but we gave into it and wallowed in our lust. Jesus is attacking the argument that your thoughts have no consequences. And he's saying it's a lie. The thoughts plant a seed within your own heart. And when you let that grow, then anything is possible. I held an accountability group at Trinity when I was in seminary for those who were struggling with addiction to pornography. We meet on Monday nights, and I just sent a general call to the student body for the man to come, and we were packed. These were men that were being trained for ministry. And the thing is before the actually started, I got phone calls from some pastors going, can I come? These men were being trained for ministry, and they wanted to follow Christ, but they could not get past their computers. And how were they to graduate and go into full-time ministry where they were going to encounter those with an addiction to pornography if they had not found healing through the Holy Spirit themselves? And they knew that, and they were miserable. How can we as Christians be faithful to our marriage vows if we are fantasizing about other people? The cost of the relationship is enormous. And even if a marriage remains intact, the intimacy is destroyed. It erodes. And this couple will never, until they turn to Christ, they will never have the primary focus of their relationship being Jesus Christ, which is the strength of marriage. Pornography is an epidemic in our world, and many marriages and children are being torn apart. But studies show that this is true within the church as much as it is in the world. And I believe it's because we've neglected to remember what it is to be holy, because our God is holy. It's the next part of this passage that bears some explanation. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. For it's better that you lose one of your members than your whole body be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. For it's better that you lose one of your members than your whole body go into hell. Now, some Christians have taken this passage quite literally, and they've mutilated themselves. One of our early church fathers, Origen, in the second century, castrated himself because of his addiction to lust. He couldn't stand it any longer. The problem is that the knife can never go deep enough, because the problem was with the heart. The problem within our own hearts is what Jesus is teaching us here, that they must be dealt with. They're so serious that we must deal with sin as radically and as drastically as necessary. Only Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit can do this. Mutilation will not accomplish this, and neither will making resolutions that I'm not going to do that anymore. We must come to that place where we are poor in spirit and crying out to God for mercy and for grace. Are you struggling with these things today? Jesus wants to set you free. Our psalm this morning is a prayer to God to focus, to help us focus on those things that keep us in right relationship with God. The psalmist is crying out to God to do the thing that only God can do, to do something within his own heart. This invitation is to change my heart. He reads in Psalm 119, 33 to 38, "Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I will keep it to the end. Give me understanding, that I may keep your law and observe it with my whole heart. Lead me in the path of your commandments, for I delight in it. Incline my heart to your testimonies, not to selfish gain. Turn my eyes from looking at worthless things, and give me life in your ways. Confirm to your servant your promise, that you may be feared." The truth is that we can never be holy as God is holy until we surrender all that we are and all that we have to him. It's only when he does this work in us that we can be healed. We can't pretend for long before we're exposed as frauds, as posers. You may have noticed that the way that Jesus is teaching in the Sermon on the Mount is by laying out what it means to follow God and what it looks like when people actually do. Following the Lord Jesus Christ and being filled with his Spirit produces such a dramatic change in every area of your life that it becomes evident. I saw that in my father. We didn't agree on a lot of things. But the one thing I was able to say at his funeral is, I hope I can be like him in his total devotion to Jesus Christ. You could not stand around Bob Moffitt very long without knowing not just that he was a Christian, but that he was anointed to be a Christian. It was his greatest delight. Conversely, pretending shows up as well. And again, I know this by the example of my mother. She pretended to follow Christ, but would not let go of hatred and anger, and it persecuted her. And the result was death. The next issue of the heart was as much a problem in Jesus' time as it is for us today. Let's read Matthew 5, 31 and 32. "It was also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that everyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of sexual immorality, makes her commit adultery, and whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery." Now, in all fairness, a little caveat here. Luke has a reading of this as well, and so does Mark, where they put the blame on the husband and the wife. So just don't get upset here. That's not fair. This applies to both. I mean, divorce was extremely common in the first century. It didn't require legal process, but a written or an oral notification was enough. Within the Jewish faith, there was a lot of teaching on the strength of the marriage covenant as it was taught in the Old Testament and in rabbinic literature. They taught that divorce could only be allowed when a man finds something indecent in his wife, and he sends her away with a certificate of divorce. Michael Green, in his commentary on Matthew, explains, he says, "The precise meaning of something indecent split the conservative school of Shammai from the liberal school of Hillel. The former restricted it to unchastity, and the latter allowed it to include burning the toast at breakfast. Accordingly, there soon developed a great disparity between the ideals and the practice in Judaism concerning divorce. And given the fallenness of human nature, it's easy to see how the interpretation of Hillel won the day with the men." But again, we see Jesus bringing an even stricter demand of the law than even the Shammai were talking about, by taking the hearers back to the original intent of marriage. Marriage was intended to be lifelong and exclusive, and to turn away from God's intention for this sacred institution was to turn away from the very heart of God. And Jesus knows the seriousness of this by saying, Everyone who divorces his wife except on the grounds of sexual immorality makes her commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. And looking back to the teaching of the Beatitudes, 4th century church father John Chrysostom posed this question. For he that is meek and a peacemaker and poor in spirit and merciful, how shall he cast out his wife? He that is used to reconcile others, how shall he be at variance with her, which is his own? To walk away from God's standard comes with the price that it leaves behind a trail of broken families, but also missing the joy of seeing God move in power even in the worst of family situations. Now, this does not mean that failure cannot be forgiven, that a Christian cannot experience joy and fullness of marriage again. I mean, there are certain circumstances that the church has said, well, we're going to live with it this time. But what you also walk away from is that you lose the opportunity of experiencing God's restorative power and the testimony of what it means to trust God and His faithfulness in every circumstance. And again, I'm not speaking from theory. I'm speaking from experience. Teresa and I have been married for almost 44 years. And we jokingly tell people we've enjoyed the last 20. And it always gets a laugh. But it's also very true. There was a time in our marriage that we could not imagine staying together for the rest of our lives. It just did not seem like that was something that could possibly happen. And divorce seemed like the only reasonable option. I wanted God to change my wife and to make her into somebody that I could love again. But God began dealing with me. And I began praying that God would change me and make me into the man that she needed me to be. And God began to change me and taught what the Apostle Paul meant in Ephesians 5:25, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. I was to see her as the treasure that God had given me. And I was to love her in the way that Jesus loved the church. Jesus did not wait until the church got its act together, and it's a good thing because we still haven't. But he went to the cross. He went to the cross for us, knowing full well of what we would be like. Because he saw us as more important than his own life. And that's how I was to love my wife. I couldn't do it. And so I asked Jesus to do it within me. You know what? If we had divorced, I would have missed out on all that God had for us, which includes you. We're here today as testimony that God can transform the hardest heart and the worst of situations if we come to Him as those who are poor in spirit, crying out for grace and mercy. Today you may find yourself in a similar situation, and Jesus wants to set you free today. Throughout this series, we've been seeing Jesus teach that what God has for us in Christ is to transform us and to restore us to that place that He always intended for us to be. He's offering us Himself, and He's offering us His kingdom. And that includes everything that we need to accomplish that. He offers us His authority in Jesus' name and the power of His Holy Spirit to indwell us in His presence. We have to come and take it by faith. And I invite you to do that today. Like last week, I'm going to go to the altar. And I'm going to kneel. I want us to take a time of prayer where we're inviting the Lord to do something in our lives, to change the things that bind us up. And I invite you to come and join me at the altar if you will. Or stay in your seat and invite the Lord to do whatever He needs to do in you, to return you to that place that He has for you in Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.